the right track. Why don't you have to paint the fish? So here they put some paint. So just easier to keep clean. So, and then yesterday at the house, rearranging each other. Like all the downstairs, they put everything. And so we don't know how to get boxes and stuff. And really big and nice. So there is a lot more room. So the big company is getting more radically.
Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Happy are those who follow the ways of God. God's ways are just and merciful. Those who follow God's ways are continually nourished in faith. In all they do, they prosper. And let us open our hearts to God's compassionate love, and let us celebrate God's mercy and justice together. Please be seated. The opening hymn number 236 is Now Thank We, O Our God. Let us bow in prayer. Beloved, be with us this day. Help us to put our priorities in order that we may faithfully serve you by serving others. Continue to heal our spirits this day and enable us to follow your ways all the days of our lives. Receive our adoration and our praise. In the name of Christ we pray. Hear and speak to us as we unite in the prayer of Christ's God.
Thank you.
you all, those of you who are gathered here in person, and also those who are gathered online this day. It's 19th of September. I'm Reverend Dr. Scott Hunter, the minister of Valois United Church. On behalf of the people, I bid you all welcome. We thank our music director, Dr. Judy Hung, for beautiful music during the service, and also Barbara Fowler, our cantor today. We thank them for their musical gifts as we gather and worship God together. On Friday, we celebrated the death of the life of Mr. Fred Walker, and the service was online for those of you who wanted to attend that way. We certainly celebrated his life together, and we continue to keep his family in our thoughts and in our prayers. Coming up this week, the Guidance Board has a meeting on Tuesday. It's Tuesday the 21st at 8 o'clock by Zoom. Deb has sent you coordinates. And we gather on a Tuesday at 8 to do our usual meeting. Also, a reminder note to those in the congregation, just here this morning, Carl was telling me about going back to the craft group. Well, the quilting group began again on Tuesday last week. It meets on Tuesdays at 1, and also the craft group met on Thursday this past week, and it meets at 1 o'clock. Now, coming up on the horizon, there's also a rummage sale that is being held on Saturday, September the 25th. You saw the signs, some of you who were here, saw signs outside of our time. It's on the 25th, it runs from 9 until noon. It says that baking will not be sold at this event, nor will there be a jewelry table, but donations of books, soft cover, winter clothing, kitchenware can be dropped off at the church the week of the sale. And help is needed, setting up on Friday, starting at 9 a.m. and on Saturday during the sale, and also for cleanup following. So if you can help with any of those things, please let Donna know. She will be very grateful to hear from you. A couple of other things. Food items are scarce in our local food bank, and so non-perishable goods can be placed in baskets here at the back of the sanctuary on any Sunday. Or they can be dropped off during the week if you call ahead. But next Sunday from 10 to 1, there is a drop-off food drive here at the church. You can also drop things off on Saturday from 9 to noon at the rummage sale. And those items will get what you need to go. If by chance you haven't had your second vaccination, then give it serious consideration. That Delta variant is being described as pretty serious for people who are unvaccinated, and we would like you to be safe. So please seriously think about going and getting it. If you have trouble with printing out or placing your vaccination QR code on a phone app, we can help you. Just drop by the church, and we'll be glad to be in hand with any of those kinds of things. Now, those are the announcements that I have in front of me at this time. I will ask, are there any other announcements that need to be made? No one is ever jumping up and down when I ask, are there other announcements? But if you do have them, please, just wave. The writer of Proverbs teaches that God's wisdom is present and active in our lives in this way. She opens her hand to the poor, reaches out her hands to the needy. And Jesus lived this wisdom in his life and called his disciples to that same generosity. Let us give out of the same generous wisdom, wisdom that seeks presence and purpose in our lives on behalf of all. After the beautiful music, we will hear the doxology and we will rise together. We will dedicate our gifts, our offerings to God.
Thank you.
take these, our gifts, signs of our gratitude, and bless them and use them for your work in the world. They are presented now in the name of the Christ. Amen. Young people, for those of you who are in a family with brothers or sisters, how many of you have been babysat by an older brother or sister? How many of you have had a younger brother or sister that you needed to babysit at some point? What happened? How did it go? Well, you think about that when I tell you a story. Okay, Judy, her mother said as she rushed out the door, you've got your list. Make sure little Tony takes his medicine before he goes to bed. And no television after 9. Your father and I'll be back by 10, and I expect you to be in bed with the lights out. Yes, Mom, said Judy as she closed the door. Why can't I stay up, Judy thought to herself. It's Friday night, I can watch my shows on TV. Why do I have to do all these things on this list? Yes, I'm in charge, but this doesn't look like it's going to be any fun at all. She turned to her 3-year-old brother, Tony, and said, young man, it's just you and me tonight. Okay, Judy, Tony beamed. Do the dishes, Judy said. She read her mom's list out loud. Check. Then she crossed that chore off her list. Give Tony a bath, she said to herself, still reading the list. Tony, it's time for a bath. Judy didn't hear any response. Uh-oh, she thought to herself. Tony is probably getting into trouble. She ran upstairs looking for her little brother. He was in his room. He wasn't in her parents' room. He wasn't in her room. Judy ran frantically around the upstairs, eliminating one room after another. And finally, she found him in the bathroom. He'd unrolled the toilet paper roll. Half of it was on the ground. But somehow she felt relieved because Tony hadn't really done anything too bad, and she could always re-roll the tissue if she had to. And with the bath water poured, Judy put Tony into the tub and began to wash him. And she washed under his right arm, and ticklish Tony collapsed in laughter. Oh, so you think this is funny, do you? Judy said. And then she began to tickle him all over as she washed her brother. Both laughed. And they laughed so hard the tears were falling down their cheeks. Yes, they made a mess, but Judy could clean it up later. After the bath, Judy tucked Tony into bed, gave him his medicine, kissed him goodnight. She cleaned up the bathroom and returned to her mom's list. It's 8:20 p.m. The chores, they're all done. The list is all crossed out. It's time for Judy to relax, watch some TV, and then she heard Tony scream, Mom! Dad! Judy! And a nightmare. Another nightmare. Judy ran upstairs. Are you okay? She asked her little brother. Yeah, but could you read me a story? Her brother said. Sure, Judy sighed. Judy began to read to Tony. The longer she read, the more excited she got about the characters in the book, and the more expressively she read. And after one book, Judy grabbed another, and then got on to the third one. And halfway through that book, Judy asked her brother, isn't this story great? It's one of my favorite books. And she looked at her brother only to realize that he was asleep. Quietly, she closed the book. She got up, she kissed Tony, turned out the light, and left the room. She looked at the clock. 10 minutes to 9 p.m. Well, Judy thought to herself, I'm going to be watching TV tonight, but it was all worth it. It was worth it. She loved her brother, and spending time with him was a lot more important than TV. The little children are important. And Jimmy knew that. Jesus knew that. Jesus told his followers that the way they treated children showed how much they loved him. They welcomed a small child, they welcomed him. And they also welcomed his father. So, young people, be kind to children smaller than you. That way you can show Jesus how much you love him. How could you help somebody who's smaller than you today? Someone like a younger brother, or a younger sister, or a neighbor who's nearby. Will you think about that for a while, as we all hear the words and music we hymn, Jesus, Friend of Little Children. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works them with willing hands. She is like the ships of the merchant who brings her food from far away. She rises while it is still night and provides food for her household and tasks for servants. She considers a field and buys it with the fruit of her hands. She plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hands to the distaff and her hands hold the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid for her household when it snows, for all her household are covered in crimson. She makes herself coverings. Her clothing is fine, linen and purple. Her husband is known in the city gates, taking a seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them. She supplies the merchant with sashes. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her happy, her husband too, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful, but beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her a share of the fruits of her hands. Let her works praise her in the city gates. The New Testament reading comes from the book of James, James chapter 3. Into chapter 4. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have a bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, Without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy, and the harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. You covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. These readings are the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gospel lesson today continues on in the Gospel of Mark. It's Mark chapter 9, verses 30 to 37. So they went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put him among them. Taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." This is the gospel of Christ. Thanks be to God. I don't think the question of greatness has gone away since Jesus' day. I mean, when I was a boy, Muhammad Ali was still boxing, and you could hear him after he was interviewed by Howard Cosell back in those days, boasting away about being the greatest. And who could forget the haunting U.S. election slogan, "Make America Great Again," that sort of fizzled during the challenge of COVID-19. They and we all continue to discuss and debate what constitutes greatness. And that question is at the heart of the gospel passage this Sunday. The scene has a very familiar ring to it, having just heard Mark's account of Jesus' prediction of his passion at Caesarea Philippi and Peter's response last week. You will likely know the similarity of the week's accounts. And this one, this week, as Jesus once again tells his followers, the disciples, that he will be betrayed and killed and rise on the third day. And as with the last time, they again don't understand or believe what he's saying, even though this is the second time that he has told them about this. And by now, I guess we can detect that this is a very common theme in the Gospels, as the disciples regularly appear, clueless indeed. In this instance, not only are they confused by his words about his impending death, they're also confused about greatness, apparently, or at least Jesus seems to think so, because they were bickering or walking from one town to another so much that he couldn't ignore it and let it go. And so he asks, "What were you arguing about on the way?" And so he asks, "What were you arguing about?" They're embarrassed to admit what they were arguing about. Was which one of them was the greatest? Now, perhaps they were boasting of which one of them had spent the most time with Jesus, or maybe which one had seen the greatest miracle, or perhaps which one had performed the greatest miracle. We don't really know. But what we do know is that Jesus is not very impressed. And so he tells them, "Whoever wants to be first, that is the greatest, must be last, and be a servant of all." Now, although this rebuke isn't as sharp as the one he offered Peter last week, and I'm sure, though, it stung. Because this is definitely not what they were taught. And let's face it, it's not what most of us are taught either. Greatness, we assume, implies power, accomplishment, fame, and wealth, and all the other things that allow you to do things, to influence people, and make things go your way. But that's not what Jesus says. And to drive his point home, he scoops up the young child into his arms and tells them that whoever welcomes a child like this welcomes him. You know, children during this COVID-19 thing have reportedly been less concerned. They seem to recover better than many of us older folk, but they seem to be less of a priority for vaccination, even though vaccination is intended for them. And perhaps we're being more cautious about them. And as an older person, though, you may have concerns, and their parents may be concerned for your safety when you're around young people. And in school, teachers may also have their worries too. And little children feel all that. They live in that day to day. Everything has changed for them. It's very difficult. It's a hard time to be a kid. We might miss the point of what Jesus is saying about children. Suddenly it seems like Jesus has gone from saying something that's just a little bit odd. First, we have to be last. To focusing on a child. Saying something that sounds a bit crazy to us. In the first century world, children were no account. Of course, their parents loved them, but they had no rights. They had no influence. They had no standing. They were utterly dependent, utterly vulnerable, utterly powerless. So how could caring for a child count as greatness? But think about it. What if Jesus is right? I mean, what if we imagine that greatness isn't about power and wealth and fame and all the rest, but instead we measure greatness by how much we share with others, how much we take care of others, how much we love others, how much we serve others. Children love to help. What kind of world would we live in? Can you imagine if people were regularly trying to outdo each other in deeds of kindness and service? If there was a national contest, competition of some sorts, not about who is the greatest singer, but who was willing to be last so others could go first? What if there were reality TV shows that followed people around as they tried to help as many people as possible? What kind of world would we live in? I don't know about you, but I think it would be a great world. It would be a wonderful world. The definition of greatness that Jesus offers might seem crazy initially, especially in the COVID-touch world today, because it's so completely and utterly countercultural. He calls us to imagine that true greatness lies in service by taking care of those who are most vulnerable, those with little influence or power, those the culture is most likely to ignore. This, without a doubt, offers us a vision for church life as well. But it also applies more personally. How are we doing? That is, by measuring our success, our greatness, not by what we take in and consume, but by what we give away. Not by influence that we wield, but by the service we offer. Not by accumulating more, but by sharing what we already have. Not by being first, by being eager to work hard in order to see others go ahead. Make no mistake, this is pretty hard stuff to live by. It's totally different than what our culture tells us, whether that was in the first century or in the 21st century. And it was so hard for the disciples, and it's so hard for us. They didn't understand what Jesus meant, and so fell into the trap of putting themselves ahead of everyone else. And we often do the same, looking out for ourselves rather than for others, trusting less in God for our security than we do in our wealth, shutting others out rather than inviting them in, seeking our welfare rather than that of those around us. But here's the thing, the road the disciples are traveling with Jesus in the scriptures, when they fall into that petty argument about who is the greatest, is the road to Jerusalem. And even while his disciples misunderstand, don't believe, or just plain ignore what he's saying, Jesus is still walking the road to Jerusalem and the cross willingly in order to sacrifice everything for them and for us too. Jesus does not give up on the disciples, not then, not now either, and still offers a different vision of greatness that can lead us to imagine and work towards a whole different world. So embrace Jesus' words once again, and know that they are still directed to those who follow, those who are gathered around him, of course, in Capernaum, but also those gathering around you this week. As Mark writes, Jesus sat down, called his disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be last must be a servant of all." And all we can say in response to that is, help us. Have mercy on us. Thanks be. Let us bow now in a moment of our prayer. Let us pray. Oh God, we live our lives as best we can, dealing with different and difficult relationships sometimes and situations, and we put our failures and disappointments behind us, and we move into each new day with as much energy and goodwill and optimism as we can muster. But here, right now, we admit we don't always have all of the answers. Sometimes we do not seek your higher wisdom in our living, and we simply move ahead. Forgive us for not asking for insight. Fill us with your wisdom, that we may live lives of goodness and peace. We are grateful that when we come before you with humility and honesty, you draw near to us with forgiveness and renewed blessing. Thanks be to you, O God. Today, O God, as we gather in this place, we pray for many lifting them to you in these moments. We offer our prayers for Sandra and for Hudson and Harrison and for Mark and family, and countless others who are in our hearts and minds and souls at these moments. We also remember our country as we go to polls in these COVID days, keep the workers and voters safe, making them mindful of what they're able to do to be safe and keep others safe. Remind us of the value of our rights, the rights of all, not just our own, a small circle of friends. Help us to make wise and good choices that are in keeping with how we view things. We pray for those who struggle with issues around food scarcity. Inspire us to give of what we have and to be generous. We also pray for those who are sick. We pray for their healing. We pray for those who are grieving losses. Remember Fred's family, particularly. Be with these folk as they find new life. Speak to our hearts and souls and minds this day, O God, and in the week that is coming. Use us in whatever way you can. Help us to do your will and also to give of ourselves generously to others. We ask all of these things in the name of Christ. Amen. Final hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be. Sink your roots deep into the soil and draw upon it. God nourishes us day with insight. Go forth knowing that God watches over you. Go now with the blessings of God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.